I would like to introduce Professor Spagnolo, who, apart from a very good friend of mine, he's a professor at the University of Padua. He is a WASOG executive committee member, and he has been recently elected as the next sarcoidosis group president in the European Respiratory Society. I've asked Paolo and Filippo, who is a patient advocate from the Italian Association, to describe to us the challenges that they are facing with the diagnosis and management of sarcoidosis patients in a different country and see similarities and differences with ours. So Paolo, over to you.
Vasilis, thank you very much for the kind invitation and thank you all for being here today. Well, to me, it's always a pleasure talking about sarcoidosis and having the possibility to discuss with patients even more than with colleagues. The main challenge, Vasili, I mean, at least to me, is managing and is also the scarcity of drugs. So the biggest obstacle or the biggest challenge to me is the development of novel drugs. I mean, we did something with a couple of colleagues last year. We reviewed all the molecules in development in sarcoidosis. I barely remember one molecule which is being developed specifically for sarcoidosis. It is either a repositioning of drugs approved for other indications or the same drugs which we use now with all their limitations in, let's say, different settings and so on. So this is one. And also how to move forward with development of novel drugs. That's another big question to me. So how do you assess response to treatment? How do you assess disease activity? And even when you see disease activity and the novel molecule is reducing disease activity, is that clinically relevant? So in terms of diagnosis, if I compare with, let's say, 20 years ago, I think we definitely know more. We are probably more capable of excluding alternative diagnosis, but the big challenge, at least to me, is management. I mean, you guys are the greatest experts on how to manage, but the therapeutic options that we have, unfortunately, are limited. So to me, the biggest challenge is development of novel molecules. I just want to say one more thing, and then I'll leave to Filippo for his comments. Research in sarcoidosis requires much more than in other conditions, collaborations. I mean, you do need big numbers, but you do need the right, let's say, representation of clinical phenotypes. I mean, 200 patients with sarcoidosis is not 200 patients with IPF, in which you do have heterogeneity, but not as much heterogeneity as in sarcoid. We do need more representation of phenotypes like, I don't know, skin sarcoid, neurosarcoid, cardiac sarcoid, and you are a master on that. And this, to me, can be reached only through collaborations, which is what I'm going to foster as a chair of the study group in sarcoidosis for DRS. These are just two or three topics which, to me, at least to me, are relevant.
Thank you, Paolo. Do you think from your end that there is any way in actually enhancing industry or pharma interest into sarcoidosis? And if you have any ideas around that?
Well, you know what, Vasili, the industry, I think, have interest in sarcoid. I mean, I've been involved actually 2 days ago as well in companies, in meetings with companies that are trying to develop drugs for sarcoidosis. I think the interest is there, but the big questions remain unanswered. For example, how do we assess response to treatment? What do we really want to treat? What is the right phenotype? Do you want to look at all comers or you want to look at pulmonary fibrosis? And if you look at pulmonary fibrosis, should we be using FVC as in IPF? But IPF is different from sarcoid. So I think the only way or one of the ways to answer these questions is to have larger number of patients, to have international collaborations. And obviously, I mean, patients on these are vital. So the interest, I think, is there, but they probably need some answers from us to move the field forward. Because the problem is that you may run the risk to discard a drug which may be somehow effective, is just you're not looking at the right population of patients.
That is an excellent thought. And do you think, from your interest, it was mentioned earlier during the day, but do you think that there is a possibility that we will reach a point where we're talking about genetic predisposition and identify whether there are groups of patients that are more likely to develop sarcoid?
Well, I mean, as you know, at the Brompton, we did some studies on this. I mean, the genetics is definitely there. Particularly, I mean, the strongest association described until now is with the so-called DR3 genotype and Lefgren syndrome. So genetics definitely plays a role. This is kind of established for acute and often self-resolving sarcoidosis. Whether this applies to specific phenotypes, the answer is probably yes, but we're not there yet. Let's say we don't have the same level of certainty as we have with Lefgren syndrome. But again, in order to have, a reliable genetic study, we need numbers. And more than numbers, we do need phenotypes. That's what we need. So large number of patients and well-defined phenotypes. Otherwise, sarcoid is not a disease in which you can find an association, unless it's extremely strong, which is, I can anticipate, this is not going to be the case. But the predisposition is more likely to be present with specific organs, which can be skin, uveitis, as in some Japanese studies, and so on. But you can do this only with large numbers. That you cannot do otherwise.
And just to come to a more recent issue, which is COVID, and it has been mentioned before, you have obviously large experience in Italy as the country hit the most in the first wave. Do you think that, first of all, there is what your view is about the entity of long COVID, and whether you think that there is any association between COVID and sarcoidosis development?
Well, as you said, Vasily, unfortunately, we had to become expert on this. Now we've been doing the follow-up of 500 plus patients, and long COVID is there. I mean, we do see long COVID in approximately, I would say, 50 to 60%. I mean, and there is a percentage of patients who are complaining of exactly the same symptoms as when they had COVID. The only difference, and a huge difference, being that now they're negative, whereas when they had all these symptoms at the beginning, they were positive to COVID. In terms of sarcoidosis, I think the patients are well aware of the risk. And so, particularly if they have extensive pulmonary involvement, I have to say that in my experience, obviously I can talk about my 700 or 800 patients, so the I don't know how many they are. And I, for example, with IPF, with the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, was completely different. I mean, I had a number of patients who unfortunately died after catching COVID. With sarcoidosis, irrespective, I would say, of whether they were on treatment or not, I did not personally see a higher, let's say, prevalence of infection, or definitely not clinically relevant disease in patients with sarcoidosis. I don't know whether you touched on this before and what your experience is, Vasily.
We had similar experience here, and I will say this more publicly. It was one of the things that we were discussing with Athol as to whether actually steroids were in a way protective against COVID for patients that were actually immunosuppressed. So we were having discussions around that issue. I think one of the main interests that patients have had is because Long COVID is primarily characterized by fatigue. They are concerned as to whether this actually represents a form of sarcoidosis, and this has been mentioned during this day. So that was another area that I just wanted to see what you think.
But I always want to say something that in our country, for example, the number of patients on biologics is relatively small due to the difficulties in prescribing these off-label medications. So when I say treatment, I would say for 95% of my patients, I mean either steroids or methotrexate or azathioprine or this kind of drugs. I mean, we don't use that many biologics. With regard to fatigue, I mean, if I have to say from a clinical standpoint, what is the largest, the highest unmet need? I think we spoke about this a few days ago. That is definitely fatigue. So in patients with sarcoidosis who get the COVID with the post-COVID, and considering that a large minority of patients with sarcoidosis complains of fatigue, that is gonna be an issue, I think. And again, I mean, we do need research on that, because what we find very interesting is that patients with COVID in post-COVID, I mean, they complain of fatigue despite rock steady lung function, chest X-ray, which has gone back to normal, and normal oxygen saturation, normal physical examination, and so on. So there must be something which I'm not sure we're missing. Probably we are not investigating properly, something to do with the muscle, for example. So we definitely do need more research on that as well.
Thank you very much. And so Athol mentioned earlier about the ERS task force with regards to guidelines for treatment in sarcoidosis. Are you aware of any further activities within the ERS group that are planned, in the sense as information for patients primarily and their physicians?
Well, I cannot wait to see the document on treatment published, because at some point I was involved in the revision of the document, but a very, very preliminary stage. And with regard to other initiative, I think what we definitely need, and this is what I'm trying to, I will definitely advocate or try to facilitate, is a document, and I want to go back to what I said before, on endpoints for clinical trials in sarcoidosis. I mean, in other diseases, because we tend to do the parallel with IPF each time, probably FVC is not ideal, but at least you have two drugs which have been approved based on FVC. We don't have the same, I wouldn't say level of certainty, because that's not certainty, but we don't have, let's say, something as reliable in sarcoid, but we need to sit around the table to see what the evidence is, what the data is, and come up with a consensus of what can be a reasonable bunch of endpoints for clinical trials, because going back to your question, that's the way we can facilitate research and interest from the pharma, because the interest is there. They just want to us, they want to know from us what they should be looking at. And to do this, we need data. And while we're waiting to collect data, we need to have at least a kind of expert opinion on this. And obviously, I mean, we should involve patients as much as possible, and we'll hear Dr. Filippo's view shortly, and younger colleagues as well, because the main problem with sarcoid, which is why I'm so fascinated by sarcoid, is that it is a real neglected disease. So we should do as much as we can, the best we can, to, let's say, rescue sarcoid and sarcoidosis patients from this, because they definitely deserve more.
I think your points are, to be honest, very well taken. And I'm really grateful for your input. I I hope that we have a very close collaboration moving on, and we both know that we are discussing about trying to identify the right study and the right design of bringing some answers to these questions. I will move on to Filippo, and I would like to thank him very much for joining. I strongly believe that sarcoidosis patients are not different, irrespective from where they come from. They may have different manifestations because there might be some genetic predisposition, although I don't think that this really stands between European and Italian patients versus UK patients and British. But Filippo, I would like to hear your views with regards to sarcoidosis in general, the patients' views in Italy, and how have you been dealing with COVID nowadays?
Okay. I thank you, and I thank you all, thank to me for this speech in this fantastic day. I find it that a great opportunity to share a lot of fantastic idea for collaborate and work to grow up all this movement. I'm Filippo Martone. I'm the president of the National Italian Association of People Suffering of Sarcoidosis, that is founded in 2011 and is made of people with sarcoidosis, their families, doctors devoted to defeat this disease. Today, it includes over 200 members among patients, physicians, researchers, and caregivers. More than 4,000 people collaborate with us via web and in other ways. Changing things has been in our mission since 2011, and information and diagnosis, treatment and access to care, policy and research are the main focuses in which our mission develops. The objectives of our association is help sarcoidosis ill people through the arrangement of correct services, to promote up-to-date research, to speed up times to diagnosis and to improve and expand treatment chances, and urge the institution to properly organize the disease medical and social taking charge. How we do it? We assist people creating a construction communication between doctors and assisted citizens through an appropriate web and telephone service over the national territory. We represent citizens to approach institutions, reporting and resolution of state of difficulty from the single citizen to the Italian struck by sarcoidosis as a whole. We represent a secure information reference through the selection of reliable information sources and the reporting of false and fraudulent information. We promote the research, stimulating scientific and research societies' challenging objective to pursue ERS, ATS, ELF, WASOD, FSR, and all the old Italian societies are currently involved by us in our stimulating opera. Raising awareness among expert centers of support for sarcoidosis research is almost doing along the whole country. Uniting clinicians, researchers, and patients on common objective by means of our official magazine that is Focus Sarco and School of Sarcoidosis that is days like today, we did along all the country four times a year or by through the web in this pandemic time. Also, we create a national database of life with sarcoidosis experiences to create a sarcoidosis culture. We encourage the institution, thanks our AXI firm commitment to urge governmental institution. For 4 years, sarcoidosis has been recognized as a rare disease and included among these pathologies was patients can benefit from completely free healthcare. In more than a few regions, major hospitals have been introducing multidisciplinary care pathways for diagnosis and treatment of sarcoidosis. Naturally, in the last year, we face the pandemic, as you told a while ago. It becomes a very tough moment. In February 2020, pandemic break through our cities and our people. Our association immediately established a direct link with the Italian Ministry of Health in order to protect people with sarcoidosis. In particular, we transfer doctors and researchers' suggestions to the direct to the ministry in order that he can take the adequate decision on what to do for these people. The same things regarding Ministry of Labor, because obviously sarco people has to stay safe at home, but also to keep their work and keep their salary safe. But also we felt a great need to discover more about the situation between COVID and sarco. And there was a great opportunity, thanks to the professor Bob Boffman, that asked us to participate in a multicentric international study that involved other countries. We had received a questionnaire, web questionnaire that we translated in Italy, in Italian, and we published in two different times, in April and in July, we and all the country involved. A lot of people did that questionnaire, over 823, but other people as enrolled by or two university hospitals. And this teaches us a very important thing that is, I think, Paolo talked to us before. Over five people with sarcoidosis in Italy answered this questionnaire, estimating that 6,000 people with sarcoidosis lived in Italy, more than 1,000 answered. If you consider that 10 years ago, we have 12 members and 50 people following activities. Now we have in a position that we can interest a lot more people, almost all the Italian people with sarcoidosis. And this is a great opportunity to develop work with doctors all together to obtain results in the way Paolo said before. We did this multicentric international study from idea to data in collected in 4 months. Also, if we work with community and non-community associations, American, Dutch, Spanish, Italian, work together very smoothly. We received some data that almost told us the same thing you told before. So the sarcoid people in that period, because we feel that now is different, in that period suffer of COVID almost in the same way that normal population in Italy. All this work is published in the end of 2020. This is the scientific work. But we felt the need to do a third step because we felt a different situation now for the people with sarco and COVID. So let's see, we will start a third step in 10 days, I think. At the same time, we are working with the Ministry of Health for vaccinate sarco people. At the present time, there is no possibility for sarco people to be prioritized in front of the other population, but I think in a couple of weeks this will be possible. So this is our little experience. I hope it can be useful for you, and I am very grateful to be there and to hear all of you. Fantastic speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Filippo. I think it is a great presentation, to be honest. I'm really interested to see the growth that you have had in such a limited time period. You have done really well. I think what you've showed us, the questionnaire example, is an example that there are many studies that are primarily driven by patients rather than doctors. And I think that this is a new step, and actually technology, as it has fast-forwarded nowadays, given the COVID pandemic, it allows for further collaborations between the patients. I think that what we need to be mindful is that the right channels of communications are made, because we wouldn't like any of these initiatives to be lost into translation. So I think that the clinician's input is critical in that sense. I just wanted to touch base on the fact that you mentioned that patients with sarcoidosis are facing some difficulties in accessing healthcare in Italy. Do you think that this is a problem, or?
Oh, it was it was a problem. We now help the centers who ask us help to build up remote visiting. Okay. In between the second and the third wave, we had the possibility to see a lot of people with sarco gaining access to the medical structures. But nowadays we are in the very middle of the third wave, and there is obviously some difficulties. Even if colleagues are trained to face the situation, and they work very hard, like the face of Paolo can testify, to cure COVID and cure sarcoid, and we don't have the same problem as the first wave or the second. This is obviously a problem that can teach us that the service for rare pathologies has to be keep safe from this great pandemic situation or great situation, because these people are very difficult pathologies, difficult because, as Paolo said, we in Sarco have very different phenotypes, and we are in the need to have a very trained, well-trained doctors to manage them. And if they are taking away for manage all the other people, we are alone. So we have to work hard with the advocacy and the policy to preserve this situation.
Vasili, can I say a couple of things very quickly?
Yes, please.
The first is that Filippo has been the driver of most of what has been shown. I mean, Filippo has been tremendous in developing and moving the field forward. This has to be said, because many of the patients or many of the people who are here know Filippo, but probably not all of them. So this has to be said. It's been great. With regard to the vaccination, in Italy, the situation is kind of heterogeneous. And now, which is good news, and this has been a couple of weeks ago, the Regione Veneto, which is the county, the region that I'm working in, is asking each of us interested in rare lung disease to give them a list of people, of patients who deserve, let's say, priority in vaccination. And obviously, I've given the name of all my patients, irrespective of sarcoid patients, of respective of disease severity, organ involvement. So probably in the next couple of weeks, most of them will be vaccinated. The problem is that this situation may vary from region to region. Yeah. But at least there is the appreciation that patients with sarcoidosis are among those who deserve a priority.
I think one of the things that this event and other events that will come are aiming for, and I think that, Filippo, it would be a great opportunity for you to actually gain experience with Sarcoidosis UK, who has been tremendous support to us and also all the sarcoidosis patients in the UK, is that I think that patients with sarcoidosis are actually neglected. The majority of the patients are considered to have a benign outcome. As Paolo said, there are not many patients, there are not many medications for them. The majority of the medications cause side effects, and this is a problem for the patients. They're not using blood pressure tablets as such, but they are causing medications that affect their immune system and have various side effects. So the important bit is that we as a team, we recognize that although sarcoid is indeed a benign condition, there are certain forms of sarcoid that are really dangerous, and we need to be very mindful of that. There are patients that end up having transplant and having a very hard time. There are others, although, that they do not have, as Athol has said, they don't have a disease that is dangerous for their life. They have a disease that is actually disabling them, and they cannot really work. They cannot look after their loved ones. So it is absolutely our responsibility to try to do the most of what we can, either as a charity or as doctors focusing on that. I think the more that we discuss, the better it is. And I must say that I'm really, really happy about the fact that sarcoidosis specialists in the UK, but also across the world, are very friendly. They don't really care about their promotion, but they do want to actually look into the scientific aspect and improve as much as possible. I'm very thankful to Athol, who has actually showed me the channel to get in communication with Paolo and other colleagues. Unfortunately, Hilario Nunes, who's another colleague from France, was not able to attend to describe the French experience, but I'm very thankful to you all for coming to this session today. And I hope that we have a long-term collaboration.
Sure.
Vasily, I think we had this conversation before. A collaboration with you guys, I mean, you are one of the largest and one of definitely the best centers in the world, but the collaboration has to take place across Europe. I mean, even a large and experienced center like yours needs our numbers, our patients, and our experience. That's all we need. Heterogeneity is such that if we don't decide what patients we want to look at, and you can do this only with large numbers, this will drive us nowhere. And to me, there is collaboration going on, but we need to reinforce this. And if I can do something with the ERS group, that's definitely what I'm going to do. Promote collaboration, try to involve young colleagues. Because, I mean, to do the sarcoid clinic, you need passion, first of all. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's all difficult, but with sarcoid specifically, you don't know the cause, it's difficult to manage. Sometimes you feel kind of guilty that you're not doing enough for patients. So what you need is a huge and endless passion. That's all we need, which is why probably we are not only colleagues but good friends.
That's absolutely the case, Paolo. Thank you very much. I know that Athol is on the call and he's going to be the chair of the next session. I don't know if he would like to comment at all, if he has anything to add.
Vasilis has a habit of ambushing me from time to time, so thank you for that, Vasilis. Yes, I just have to reinforce what Paolo says, and I'll give you an example. There's a worldwide initiative now to separate lung sarcoid into separate, we call them phenotypes, separate disorders based on radical differences in CT. And I think if that's going to be explored, and I think if we then go on to look at genetic associations linked to individual triggers, linked to particular patients, we can't do that without the gift of numbers. And we're going to need to invite thousands of patients to take part in research. We're really entering key stages now with these growing collaborations, where we have huge opportunities, and it's people like you, Vasilis, and you, Paolo, that will make this happen at the end of the day. So I can only support what you've said, Paolo, and only congratulate Filippo on what he's done. I've really got nothing else to add, I think.
Thank you very much.